can't come anywhere.
Well, why not? You know what I mean? What is the general perception of the flat Earth? That's what we get. Yeah, we see it as crazy. I'm sure the hoax. Hell, you can tell it's real because it looks so fake.
That's what I thought.
That is pure mental manipulation from the masses. You can tell it's real because it looks what he's telling people there is, don't worry about the fact that it looks really, really fake. If it was fake, we'd make the CGI a lot better. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. And, you know, the penny doesn't drop for people because it's just this belief and trust in all authorities. You know, the big thing with fake news and stuff, is, you know, start to call, you know, what's real news, fake news, and what's fake news, obviously. We can tell ourselves, you know. Let me ask you a question.
Just bear with me. There's no one watching.
So. These questions. Do you believe globe workers are not on the same level as us? Do you find it boring or awkward spending time with globe workers because they don't understand the flat earth? Have people ever said that you push it or obsessive about the flat earth? No, don't ever mention that to you. I'd say we could probably all answer yes to half of these questions.
You can't have both, you can either have audio or visual, that's it. Do you pay for an expensive ticket to get both? Someone just said they're going to share it. It probably won't update until afterwards or something. Don't worry about it.
The last question is, do you sometimes feel that you know more than globe earthers about life, about people, about the world? Now, the reason I ask those questions, shame they're not really, you know, still up there, but they are going to be in a minute, I'm sure, is because those questions I actually took from a
service, and it basically is, am I in a cult? Yeah? Questions to ask yourself, say, am I in a cult? Now, don't worry, I'm not going to say, you know, there's the laughter and all that nonsense. It's not at all, we do live on a stationary plane, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that we need to be careful that we don't have our whole life and world about the planet. Yes, it should inform who we are and how we go about things. I mean, for me, led to the Bible, led to the truth of God and Jesus. I know that's half of you and not half of you, whatever, you know what I mean? I'm not here to do a religious thing, but really, we should make sure that it's our relationships with people that are important. Yeah? Waking up, you know, having an awareness, having a spiritual revolution, etc. It's about how we are as people in the world and being a force for positive good. Now, you know, splitting up with your wife and, you know, not being with your friends anymore and all the rest of it is obviously the opposite to that. So, on one level, Flat Earth is the most important thing because, like I say, for me, it led to God and the Bible. And hopefully, you know, salvation and eternal life. And that informs how I deal with the world and, you know, with other people. But on the other level, you've still got to live your life. You've still got to be in the world. You've still got to go to work in the morning. You've still got to have relationships with our families, with our friends, with our co-workers. And if they get annoyed every time you bring up the fact that Elon Musk is a liar, it's counterproductive, isn't it? Yeah, we can have fun with it, and it's great that we can have a convention like this and all get together and talk about whatever people want to get, you know what I mean? We're not crazy, man, you know what I mean? It's great to do. We did have a group, you know, the vehicles we used to do it on, the same thing with camping, you know what I mean? And it's self-generated, so you can, you know what I mean? You meet up yourself and meet up with like-minded people, it's absolutely great. But I think the idea of everything in your life is about birth. Now, when you're new, that's fair enough, because it's such an amazing revelation, it really is. You know what I mean? We're taught from a very young age, all now, that we're in the world, we're in the vast universe, and it's an amazing revelation when you find out that's not true. And that, you know, whether that's at the start or the end of all the revelation, you realise that everything that we've been taught needs to be reassessed. And it should be at this expense of how we deal with people in our lives. Yeah. So, obviously, I've asked those questions. Can we get this feedback? I mean, I can rap for a while, but...
Martin, all the hookers are free. Technical difficulties.
You are listening.
No, I'm not listening, I'm reading. Hey Martin, how are you? Martin, can you do me a favour? Can you share it in all the Flat Earth groups? All the Facebook Flat Earth groups for me. Cheers.
No, I'm still at home.
If anyone else can share it with the groups, that'd be great.
And don't stop thinking cult and group life, yeah? Be an independent thinker. Independent thinker is not being part of a group and going, all right, well.
Hello.
Hey!
So being an independent thinker does not mean going along with the group, yeah? That person says that, everybody believes that, therefore I must believe that because I believe the earth is flat, okay? Have your own ideas, which I, you know, certainly do. Don't know if you ever come across the Delphi technique. It's used in local meetings for Agenda 21, for Agenda 2030 to manufacture consensus. Generally in meeting rooms, it gives people the impression that they've contributed, and they're going to have the impression that, yes, that's the consensus that we came out with. If you can do it in meeting rooms for Agenda 21, you better believe we can do it on the internet. You know, so again, social media is so easy to organise groups and to get groupthink going and consensus. So just watch out for it, is all I'm saying.
Some examples of other things on the internet that came along after the flat earth. The Mandela effect. Now this has actually been documented as a psyop. Yeah, the woman who came up with it actually documented it as a psyop. And I just find it funny. I love this meme. Nick Habbett does brilliant meme for the Black Flat Earth and various other things as well. So, you know, they can go back and change time with a Hadron Collider. So what we're going to do, we're going to change some popular culture things. What? Not going to happen. I think a lot of these things are to distract from the realisation of the Flat Earth. And also, again, to make the Flat Earth look kooky. Because a lot of Flat Earthers will also go, oh yeah, have you heard about the Mandela Effect? To be honest with you, I never heard about Nelson Mandela dying the first time and then he was still alive. I only heard about it, fair enough. I only heard about it when he actually died. But I don't watch a lot of telly screen anyway. Then we've got there are no forests on the flat earth. It is complete bullshit. Very plausible at first. But then again, when you start there, and it went viral and it was a very, very interesting concept. But then you go, well, hang on a minute. Silicon doesn't form life, not yet anyway, that might change, the whole chemistry and everything might change, but right now carbon forms life, silicon can't form life. And also, if these tree stumps, there'd be huge roots. There would be huge roots underneath, we'd know about it. Yeah. Again, another distraction. Also came after, every Hollywood actress is a man, and every Hollywood actor was a woman. because we've had plastic surgery. I'm sorry, but they both look like women today. That one never grabbed me, I must admit, but again, went all over social media.
Michelle Obama.
Again, examples
Michael, not
of
a woman.
Thing.
Michael,
think for yourself, and you go, no, I'm not going with that one. Here's one of many pictures that we see of the ice wall. The big ice wall that surrounds the circle flat earth idea. All you have to do there to get the original photo, see, it's an ice shelf. Things can be manipulated, yeah? Be aware of it. There's lots of pictures, memes that could have used, showing, oh look, you know, here's the ice wall, here's the ice, it's just there are 300 miles of ice shelf, of glaciers at the Ross Ice Shelf. Doesn't prove anything. What we're given is a false dichotomy or a black or white fallacy. Who remembers Georgie Bush? You're either with us or you're with the terrorists. That's the choice you've got.
Yeah. Martin, can you hear anything?
To be honest with you, I don't want to do either, George. You're all terrorists. But that's how it works. We'll give you one or the other, and you kind of choose. And that's how the flat earth's gone. You know?
Sadly, it's the best that we got, so turn your volume up.
Yeah. What happens is instead of considering genuine flaws in each model, the response is to attack the other model, talking about ball earth, circle earth. Does the truth matter? I'll tell you what I've heard a lot. Well, it's the closest model we've got, it's the best one we've got, you know. Yeah. Makes the most sense. But there are
I'll get it to smile for you.
With the ball. So why would you believe either? Yeah. I don't believe the model on the left. I don't believe the model on the right. There's various problems. What you get is, like I say, well, tomorrow we're gonna have a debate with physicists. And what they're gonna do a lot is attack the official circle model. That's what they're going to do, and they'll be right about it as well. But what they won't do is listen to the criticisms of the ball. Yeah, the ball explains some things, and the circle model explains some things, but neither model explains all things. I don't think anybody's got a model. I'm going to show you an idea of mine. I'm not going to say, this is the model. I'm going to say it's an idea. And it's what I came up with, just doing my own research and doing my own thoughts on it. Some reasons. Well, Yeah, the other thing is the circle model, as far as the rest of the world's concerned, you see the articles about the flat earth when they had the US conference, there was a lot of coverage in the media, and that was the model that was presented. That's the flat earth. It wasn't for all of us, but as far as the rest of the world is concerned, that's the flat earth. And like I say, I believe it's provably wrong. I'm not going to go into it in great detail because I did do another presentation at New Horizons last November. It hasn't been published yet. I held it back because of the convention. Well, I'll go into these things in a lot more detail. But there's 20 reasons that you can research for yourself why the circle model doesn't work. In general, Earth is two equal halves. Whatever shape it is, it's two equal halves. This is not an Earth of two equal halves. It's a tiny north of the equator, and south of the equator is huge. And that means everything is wrong about that. Think about it. Daylight hours, the speed of the sun and the moon, the size of the continents, flights. Yeah? It has to be equal in whatever way, whether it's squared, diamond, whatever it turns out to be. Yeah, it has to be equal north and south of the equator. Yeah. I'm not going to go into into each point because we're probably running short of time already. What I found over the last 2 or 3 years, I mean, if you remember my presentation in January 16, the big one, it's been seen by 1 million people now on YouTube at New Horizons. I said right away at the start of that, I don't believe that the circle model is the flat earth, and I actually, and since then, ever since then, I get the same response from flat earthers, or a lot of flat earthers, I did, as we get from ball earthers. Yeah? Same defensive response. So, again, this is some kind of programming and court washing going on. Let me ask you, is anybody who, any voice of the flat earth, including me, is anybody an explorer? A noted explorer or a scientist, I know scientists with credentials doesn't really, it doesn't necessarily mean that they've got the truth, but at least they can experiment. I mean, obviously we've had the Brazilian film recently where they did some very, very good, all the experiments that we wanted to do, they've done it with great equipment and all the rest, we've all seen that, and then they come up with, another strange model, but, again, you take what you can, you take the good bits, the truth, and obviously, and discard what doesn't work. So, if you don't have any qualifications, why trust them implicitly? Why trust everything they say? The reason we do that is because they might be the first people that showed you that NASA were liars and that we're not on the ball. And that's fair enough, yeah? But it doesn't mean that everything we say is going to be true. Everything needs testing, yeah? So most people, they're just, YouTubers, yeah? They might be able to do various other things, but then if somebody had been an explorer, 50-year experienced explorer, then they've got a lot more weight to what they say. So just do your own research and be your own authority. And the other thing is that they will say it is like this, and anybody who disagrees is really working to promote.
Yeah, it's Darren Nesbitt.
You know what I mean? You just take people for what they say. What we need to do is gather the facts and create a theory from the known facts. Not the other way around. Have a theory and then we're going to find all the facts of this. It's an ice wall there, so let's get some pictures of ice shelves and show you the ice wall. Somebody shows me verifiable video evidence and what have you of the dome. There's the dome.
No, he's not pushing AE.
There's the dome edge. I've never seen it. There's anybody else. Now that's after, four or five years of the bigger flat earth out there. Nullius in verba. Take nobody's word for it. Evidence, multiple verifiable evidence all the time. Now we can be deceived. And the best time to deceive us is when we've been told an amazing, mind-blowing opening truth. Stick other things in there while your mind is open. Can you hear me okay at the back?
Yeah.
So, Sherlock Holmes, or is it Watson? Once you eliminate the impossible, whatever remains must be the truth. Evidence-based, skeptical, truth-seeking and research. Yeah? You discount what doesn't work,
and see where the corridor leads. And like I say, what I'll present now, only in picture form, I've done a full animation video on my YouTube if you want to see it. It's my idea. I'm not saying this is the idea. I'm saying this is a possible possibility for you to consider.
Based on what?
Here's what we know for sure. We live on a stationary land. We know it's not moving. We trust our senses and not the model in our heads anymore. Everyone lives on top of the land. We're still waiting for the money shot of the hobble being turned around and showing us people in Africa walking sideways on a ball. Zoom in to galaxies thousands and millions of miles away. Just turn it around, zoom in on Earth, and let's see that upside down. Or the people upside down in Argentina, etc., etc. Everybody lives on top of the land. Big flat station of life. There's no edge. There's no boundary. Nobody ever falls off. Ah, the earth's flat. Cats would have pushed everything off it by now. There's no boundary, continuous, you know, planes and ships obviously continuing to travel east-west with no impedance. So, a logical possibility, and I came across this from a YouTuber called Free Energy, is that we know the three dimensions, but Earth itself is bound in four dimensions. It's a little bit weird to get your head around. Not teleporting or transporting from one side to the other. It's the space itself, it's Earth itself that just repeats around. So again, just like with the flat Earth, you either get it or you don't. It seems really weird, or it's like, oh, okay, yeah. Well, again, this is why nobody's ever fallen off. The Bible supports this as well. The Bible in Job says the seas are shut up with doors. Doors allow two-way passage. So, well, the doors might be shut, but we call it a wall. Some kind of physical boundary. So the doors. So God's decree shut up the oceans.
I don't know.
And ancient Egyptian cosmology also says the same thing. You've seen the goddess Nut, stars, the moon, the sun entering. Either entering the mouth, coming out the womb, or the other way around. So, we know the pyramid exists. Giza used to be a lot more impressive looking than that. It's impressive anyway. It was the tallest structure on Earth for 3,500-4,000 years until the Eiffel Tower was built. It's becoming in white casing stones. Why was it built? Again, lots of ideas, but no real proof for any of them. I mean, you know, if it was going to be built for a green store, it's a bit elaborate, isn't it? Instead of a barn, it's another big barn. It could be any of these things, but there's no evidence for any of them. Yeah, it could be all of them. What is evidence in it is its actual structure, its geometry, and its internal structure. I don't know if you know, the pyramid is more aligned to true north than the Greenwich Observatory. That's pretty impressive for people, supposedly, who just come out of caves. They knew something. These shafts are actually completely unique. No other pyramid on Earth, I know there's lots of pyramids around, but no other pyramid on Earth has these unique shafts. What were they for? They were only discovered, the King's Chamber shafts were discovered in the 17th century, the Queen's Chamber shafts only in the 19th century. And they were sealed. So, if there was an observatory for stars, or it was ventilation shafts while they're building, they're about 8 inches square, the King's Chamber was. Okay. At the end of the day, they'd have built the pyramid up, so you need ventilation, it's coming out of the roof. So, began to ponder
what the shacks were for, if they're not for any of the, you know, mainstream or major ideas. Again, observing stars. Again, a bit elaborate, just go outside. So, I extended the shafts out. And you know the pyramid also encapsulates pi and phi, all the mathematical stuff. It's a, like I say, it's a geometrical and mathematical larvae. I believe the pyramid was built for its geometry. It's enclosed in itself, not for any other purpose than to show us perfect geometry and geography. And it encapsulates pi, so there's got to be circles. And I started drawing circles. You know, a big circle, and two circles, and four circles, and how does it all fit together? And eventually I stumbled across, you take a circle with a radius from the King's Chamber to the floor of the pyramid, and you get some interesting things happening. What we see is the circle's tangent, the shaft lines, pretty perfectly. Both the ascending passage and all four of the King's Chamber passage and the Queen's Chamber passages are actually going to come to the outer ones.
This is going to be his model.
Like I say, I mean, I think we long suspect that the ancients knew a hell of a lot more than we do. Tell us that, or we can pretend that we're advancing because we've got an amazing gadget in our pockets. And we can communicate to the other side of the plane. But I think we're actually going backwards in terms of, you know, real knowledge, real life, real science. You see a pattern starting to form, which we're quite familiar with. You say, well, you know, this is UH sacred geometry. It's just geometry. Circles, lines, triangles, squares. It's perfect geometry. It's how you build a building. God is the creator, whoever you think God is. It's pretty obvious he's the creator. That's one thing that the flat earth does reveal to us. We're not randomly, a load of dust started spinning and it became rocks, and then rocks started clumping together and became a planet. Not very likely, there is a creator. And the creator is going to design something with perfection. And that's what, that's what I thought. The Bible says the earth has four corners. We can say the earth is almost definitely two equal halves. We know that from, you know, people's travel. So we put all that together. We can start to see an interesting idea. The Bible also says the earth is on pillars. Now, whether you've seen pictures of the earth on pillars, it's these long leg things outside it. We're not like to support it. Again, like I say, I've animated all this on a video. For now, we're just going to get the next picture along. Seven pillars to support the earth. I looked at, when I originally started an animation, I looked at the square locator, or rectangular locator. The problem with this for me is that the equator is the longest line of latitude. Again, by people who navigate, people who travel for thousands of years, millions of people travel all over the earth all the time, shipping on air now. The equator is the longest line. As you go away from the equator, north and south, the lines of latitude get smaller and smaller. So, whilst the idea of the four-dimensional earth, the repeating space, these three images, I don't agree with, he likes the rectangular model. I think it's more of a diamond. Something around that. But what I actually did was put that with the pyramid, or the double pyramid. And what we get is something like that.
say it's a repeating space, there are no edges as far as we're concerned, this is how it looks to God. On pillars. Obviously, I don't think there's a flower of life for it there. The deep is probably waters. Lots of ancient myths. Same here, supported by turtles, coming up with turtles. We've also got Hercules holding up the earth. Again, another plausibility. We know that the firmament is also on pillars, the pillars of heaven. God likes the number 7 and he likes the number 12. That's why he's written with 12 pillars. If you can just make out there, here at the bottom, I'll put a firmament over it. There is definitely some kind of firmament. Probably a flat one. Maybe. All the idea of this is to show you it's a different idea to what we've been used to. Go and see where it goes. Try something else. Try your own ideas. Don't have to go along with the manufactured consensus. I know from my own personal research that the circle Earth, the AE model, is flawed. Because it's flawed, it stops the flat earth realization growing. Not saying the diamond model is correct, it could be something else. But when we keep promoting that circle model, it's so easy, it's such a good easy straw man for people to attack or prove wrong, that they don't then get off the ball. I'm just gonna show you very quickly some animations. So I'm gonna end. Blender. How astronomy works with a two-pole equal model. No, it still seems to be on that. Why is that? One of the biggest criticisms of the circle dome model is how do the stars work? How do the two pole stars work? First of all, you get, there are two pole stars. Yes, they are. Well, they're just the same stars, but they're reflected. No, they're not. They're different stars. Or it's just a personal sky that follows you around. No, it's not, because we've been able to make astronomical predictions for thousands of years. Ptolemy sat out the jest, stood for 1400 years, all eclipses, planetary movements, etc, etc. Very, very simple with this kind of model. As you can see, we're looking north, and the stars simply rotate around somewhere around there, the North Pole. Polaris is about half a degree off it. If you look east, stars rise. Look west, that's how it looks south. As we know, the stars rotate clockwise around a southern pole. No need for reflections, no need to, obfuscate or anything like that. That's simply how this is what we actually observe. You look west, the stars set. You look up, see the planets there as well, but the stars go straight overhead. Again, with the dome model, there's nowhere where the stars would go straight overhead. They'd always be circling tighter and tighter. They'd only be one pole. Very, very simple, very, very easy way of showing how astronomy works. Observable known astronomy that thousands and thousands of people all over the earth observe with some kind of two-pole model. Whatever the shape of the lamp, whether it's this diamond, or whether it's a square, or whether it's whatever it is, an oval, two-pole stars. Okay? One more. Show you how the solar system. There is a solar system. Planets go retrograde. Again, observe astronomy will tell you that. You can go, well, the planets don't exist, what have you. You want to study them, you study what you've observed and what's been observed for thousands of years.
You will see that there are certain things that have to fit in with known observations. Obviously, we've got the sun going across, let's put the moon on. I believe the moon is lower and smaller than the sun, but obviously from the way we see it on Earth, it looks the same size. That's because of the eclipses. Eclipses also explains why eclipses go from west to east, because the sun moves faster than the moon. And also why eclipses can be seen, you can get them right at the poles. You can get them right at the north, just touching the north pole, just on the south pole, because of the difference in height between the sun and the moon. And obviously they will both travel between the tropics. One second.
Transit the sun. It goes across the face of the sun from time to time. It never transits the moon. So, that must be how it goes. Same with Venus.
It's because it's up higher than the moon.
Venus can see also transits the sun from time to time, but not transits in the moon. You see that quite clearly? It's in the circle. Mars. We don't see transits of the sun. Mars must be circling outside. Outside of the length of the Earth. Obviously, it doesn't crop into the ocean either. There are seven planets. We've only had an identity five of them. I believe there are seven outer planets, the Uranus and Neptune. I don't believe Pluto is a planet. They made it up. It's always like the same. But that's what we're all shown as children. Solar system. Yeah, so it's exactly the same, except we've got a flat Earth and the solar system is actually perpendicular.
Hi, Eric.
Welcome. We're all on the same horizontal plane. The planets go around the sun and the sun crosses the Earth. It's a Helio system. Again, I've done videos where I go into it in more detail, just to show you just a little bit.
Hey, Eric.
Today. Okay, so I'll wrap up with the last slide. Hopefully, it's been informative and something new for a lot of people. Famous Illuminati card. We know everything. You know, somehow everything on the Illuminati cards has either, you know, most of them come true, like Twin Towers and, you know, various things. It's interesting to know the shape of the Earth on them. It says flat Earthers know something. They know something.
I'll give a wrench to we'll have get that idea off.
I think it might be decades yet. And I think it's worth spending our time being open-minded, talking, not dismissing ideas, not going along with groupthink. Yeah? I can't be in the flat earth club if I don't believe this, that, or the other. Yeah? Being an independent, a genuinely independent person. I pride myself on it. Yeah, it can be hard at times. You know, you do get a lot of backlash. But people who disagree with you, they're not working necessarily, we're a few for the government. And they say, I'm a musician from Manchester. Yeah, I have no vested interest. Don't sell t-shirts or books. I sell CDs. That's my only one and only point. Be aware of self-deception. We lie to ourselves a lot. We do. Oh yeah, I've preserved something. Anyway. Yeah. Do it. Keep your feet on the ground. Yeah? It's the only place to put them, unfortunately. But keep your feet on the ground, seriously. Keep perspective of where we are in terms of, you know, the flat earth realization of the rest of the world, the rest of the world. Beware of psychological techniques, always do your own research, and accept, hey, you might be wrong. I like being wrong if I've been shown better information. I'm like, oh no, it's all about that, thanks for that. Really? There's a lot of hubris, especially the internet. You're going to be seen to be really clever and smart all the time. Everybody wants to prove how brilliant they are. That's another thing that social media does that we should be, you know, aware of. Let's get back to pubs, reopen pubs. Remain open, look for multiple verifiable evidence. And let's work together instead of arguing, well, Well, thank you very much for listening to me today. I hope you enjoy the rest of the convention. I hope you see some.
Right, guys, just quickly, I'm going to do this most of the day for the speakers. Be nice. Eric was invited because he knows his stuff. And if you don't like it, you have to leave. Eric was personally invited to come on it. The other thing is, I'm going to do it on each speaker. So every time, I'll have to probably put up a new link because I'm going to need to charge it as well, etc., etc. But any nonsense and you have to go, and also I don't know how to give a wrench out, I'm going to try and find that, so yeah, someone can monitor it. For now, thanks again, I'll give you another link when it goes. Cheers, bye. And Eric's a good guy. You're an idiot, whoever you are. You're not coming back.
Hello everyone, obviously yes, yeah.
Okay, so we go again.
It's designed for a small phone.
Oh no, you don't, mate. You would end up killing them all out. We are back. Martin, share the link in the Facebook groups, please. No idea, Pulsar, no idea. That's the name of the group, we've got no idea. I think Iro Landucci's from Argentina. I don't know anything about him, to be honest. Luckily. Go to here.
Stop it. Don't worry about it. It'll get in a minute.
I'll do it this afternoon, Mark. Thanks. Now might be a nice breaking proceedings for me.
It's cool because it's carried on the same stream.
Yeah, it's carried on the same stream. Yeah. It's a bit bizarre. A few technical difficulties. Jeez. Okay. Everyone is going to the toilet or leaving while the technical issues are on. Loves UK garage. That's on his t-shirt. No one's commented on my t-shirt.
Some of you then. Can we have the break now? No, I don't think we're supposed to be having a break. I think there's just a technical difficulty and the presentation's getting lost a bit. I might have to nip to the car a bit and get some things. And then, right, back in a minute. Are you coming? You want to go for, get stretch your legs or not? I can't leave my phone here.
No, I'll wait with the thing, yeah?
All right.
I'll wait with this because I'm going to stop it, do you?
Yeah, I don't know.
In case it starts, yeah. You guys go
Before we do the stream next time, we'll break it after lunch and then focus it on.
You charge it after lunch. Yeah.
Right, see you in a minute, mate.
Yeah, see you in a minute.
See ya.
Yeah.
Because we've got 2 minutes break for earrings, can anyone do me a favour? Stand up.
Yeah.
Please, stand up.
What
I'd like you to do is I'd like you to try to face somebody that you either have to speak to or you don't really know them. So you can say if you're actually looking at a friend, I want you to actually look at somebody who you pay attention to and find out that they are like open views, that they're just literally people you don't know very well. Find somebody that you haven't really connected with yet, and one of you, I want you to say 3 words. And I want the other person from this turn and react to those 3 words. So can you do that in the next couple of seconds? Find somebody and connect with them.
Hi there, how you doing?
Hello, I'm
Jim. Scott.
That's 3 words.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Where are you from?
Aldershot.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
From Dorset.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So from this morning, yeah. We're trying to do like a live stream thing of it for everybody.
So you've got like a YouTube channel.
Yeah. Well, Ian has just gone back to the car. He's got a channel, so he's trying to stream it and everything.
The only bad thing about doing it on a phone, you're limited with battery time.
Yeah, I know. I'm going to charge it up at lunchtime.
Yeah,
that's good, isn't it? It's good.
Yeah.
Were you here yesterday?
No, it's our first day.
Yeah, same here.
We're just coming for today.
Yeah, he's coming for today.
It's nice to hear some sort of different perspectives. And I like the fact that he was only talking about anything that can be proven, not necessarily like pictures of like round Earth. Because it's good, because the trouble is, even coming from like a globe Earth to a round Earth, it's still the same. Still a circular shape.
Yeah.
So, I'm a Christian. Are you a Christian?
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, more so, yeah. I think.
I mean, in the Bible, it states four corners, so maybe, don't necessarily think about that shape. It might be square, it might be rectangular, I don't know, But I like some of the models he was showing about it disappearing off the edge and then coming back round. That point is sort of observed. But.
Okay, the 3 words I want you to say to that other person is, you ready? I love you.
Come on, Jim. I love it. I love everyone. I'm a pretty positive person, you know. I'm not like, could do a bit more love in the world. Could do it a bit more love in the world. I'm Scott, pleased to meet you.
I love you, I guess.
Yeah, I need to. Love you too, man. We're doing a bit of group hug work.
Can I just mention to you guys that go and get coffee or go to the toilet anytime you need. You know, lots of this isn't from there, you can't keep it there. So we are going to have lunch at some point.
Please, sir, can I go to the toilet?
It's the area that's got about 2 hours on vacation. Excuse me, guys. Hello. We've got 2 hour presentation here, but we can't do this in one hit. So what we're going to do, we're going to do some before lunch, a little bit after, possibly, and then the rest is going to be tomorrow. Unfortunately, Mike Kavanagh, his wife, became ill the other day. She was rushed into hospital with breathing difficulties, so he hasn't managed to watch the event, which is a big shame, because he was not only the organizer of the Balaton experiment, he also actually recently went to Holland with Didi and a few other people. And I just wanted to, I did not want to kill his thunder, but he actually... 2 minutes, okay. I don't want to kill his thunder, but yeah. All I will say is that the actual information that he's produced is actually quite significant. And for the people in the room that saw it with Anthony Riley and Nathan Oakley, he was talking about a test from Sophie's to Iron Man that was apparently 34 miles. He actually presented it yesterday. And can I just say that the people that were in the room last night, can you put your hand up and just to see a contrast between the people that did sit and the people that didn't? Can you put your hand up, please? Okay, it's about just under half the room, it looks like, but the actual information that's coming out with Balaton, what's happening in Holland, what's happening in St. Pete's, Bob Darien's actually looking at doing the microwave testing that's actually coming up in the near future. And one of the things I really think that we need to do is that we need to network with each other to try and look at what we can do in experiments. I want to just do a little demonstration with this tentacle. If I actually throw this tentacle wherever it lands, if we say that this is the distance that is the furthest that anyone's ever thrown a tentacle, wherever it lands is the world record. The thing is, that when we're talking to people about the Earth's curvature, they can't grasp what it's meant to be. So if we say that by this point you should have had curve, or this point you should have curve, they can't relate to that. If you said to the world record for the tennis ball first throw is here, and you happen to throw another 6 inches or even 6 millimeters, they actually will then go quantify at what point is the world record. Does that make sense to you? So we have a point here that they can actually tangibly work out where the world record is. But when it comes to the curvature, you can say to people, if it's 34 miles from the edge to the Isle of Man, and it's actually giving you the curvature should be whatever it's going to be, might come 0.667 to give you the actual the drop. They can't equate that. They can't understand what you're saying. So they wouldn't know that, wow, that's powerful. So unfortunately, all the while we're into that Earth and we're talking about curvature, people that are not into that Earth can't tell. They don't understand. Does that make sense to you guys, what I'm saying? Yeah? Okay. Also, it's got this stuff there. Can I just also mention how I'm going to take that material? There was a situation last night where a guy came up with the open mic, and he actually said to people about, I can't remember exactly what the context, but he actually was saying something. He was actually saying about something like an idiot. And I actually said to him, I said, can you do me a favor? Can you please stop using the word idiot? And the thing is, we've been conditioned about what we can and can't do. So what he did is that when I started to say that I need to have a chat, he actually assumed that I was going to say use the other word. And he started putting his hand up in an apology, which I just felt is just something I've played with. But at the same time, which is we are conditioned what we can and can't do. You know, you've got people that tell you that you can't do this. But doesn't that then? Who am I going to tell you what you can and can't do? the sins and ways of, that's why we have to not only have some vision, but we don't work together as a collective to actually possess. Yes, exactly, that's a very good point. So I think we are in a special situation here. We need to use all things in network. On that note, I'm going to pass on to Mr. Lee now. Good.
Because for me that is the most important part, understand who present as the heliocentric model. So it's going to be a little mix up, you know, technical stuff, symbolic things. It's going to be really deep, the rabbit hole this time. So I hope you can understand me. First of all, thanks to Gary, to Didi for inviting me here. Thanks. So thank all of you for having me here. It's really a pleasure to be part of Flat Earth Convention. It's a lot of work to put something like this in real life. It's taken a lot of effort to do this kind of thing. So for me, coming from Argentina, it's also really, you know, an adventure. In South America and in the Spanish language in general, there are a lot thousands of people coming to the Flat Earth reality. So they want to see this also. I hope you. They say that our English is so bad that they can also. You know, so maybe it's like a mother language, something like that. You want to try the sound? I do. No, it's not working. Because he says Spanish. This is my YouTube channel. I have 90% of the content in Spanish, but I have a few 10% in English. So if you want to check out, that is my YouTube channel. I don't want to forget to give the thanks also to the Globaster guys, because they allowed me to be part of this event. You know, they received me every Sunday in the Globaster show, so thanks for the more guys, Sharon and Bob. And okay, let's start it. I have my name, I have 37 years old. I was born in La Plata, it's a city near to Buenos Aires, and like Washington City or like London City is founded by Freemasonry. So I need to live with that every day that I walk around. And my job for living is the visual effects technical director from a quite times now. I do 2D and 3D motion graphics, so my introduction to the flat earth was from Matt Pamela, like I said before yesterday, but also when I started looking the visual effects that NASA uses in his light feeds and that kind of stuff. So that part of my professional background allowed me maybe to, get more deeper into the NASA hoax. And as a researcher, I am a researcher some 13, 14 years from now. I'm studying like the most of you, looking into the 9/11, the vaccination, the geoengineering things, that kind of thing. But what really waking me up at the age of 21, 22 years old was an out-of-body experience. Before that, I just he was a regular guy based on science. I get out for religions like 15 years old. And I believe that when you die, nothing more will happen. And the universe showed me that that is not the case. So I started to research in metaphysics things and that kind of stuff based on that experience. Then from 4 years now, I become a flat earth researcher with, what that means in the... One more time, yeah? Oh, one more time. So, that is a little about my background. I'm also, I'm not a specialist, but I take a lot of time researching in language, the real meaning of the word, that a little deeper than the etymology, and also the, and I recommend this for everyone.
I'm so sorry, man. The
general medicine, the Dr. Hammer research, they are really amazing. And if you want to understand a little more why we get sick, and based, of course, the normal medicine, they know that 99% of the diseases are psychological. And if you want to understand that, and at least, of course, you're not going to avoid death, but at least you can understand why you get some disease. From a head pain to a cancer, it's all emotional and business. Please, it's not problem. Give applause, please. Thank you. You try. Let me back again.
Okay, cool. A bit, but I like this conversation.
Like it.
The next time I call security, okay? So, please. So, I really recommend the neurological, the neurological part of the disease, and that is the shamanic medicine. This is my YouTube channel. I have a lot of, like I said before, a lot of content in Spanish, but I also participate with a few English people that allow me to be part of the English community. Santos Bonacci is one of the greatest men that I ever met. Marma Queen, Antonio Sumidas,
this is a
famous. Blockbusters, etc., etc., etc. I think you know it, every one of those. So, in Argentina, I am not a media guy, but this topic of flat earth bring me into the mass media situation, So I start having a little participation, and that's allowed to grow the movement because it's getting out just in the YouTube channels. And that's also caused me a letter from the Astrophysics University from my city, because I was in the public TV program saying that the dinosaur was a hoax, the ISS doesn't exist, the moon landing never happened, and this guy started to put a little nervous. So they present an official letter against me, calling me liar and you know, that kind of thing. They sign it, everything. Of course, I just make it and drop away. But I show these because these are the implications that we have to live for talking about this. It's just I know our voices are here out there. That is, they are so worried. It's just not a local thing. This is around the plane that we are really growing up. Of course, in my country and in South America, there exists the same kind of fake news, you know, in Spanish version, but we have the same type of media, so they pick up information from here and just replicate in their journal. So it's the same thing. The world is really small. So, so what made me ask the question about the Candy Early flag? I showed this little clip always because after entering the flat earth, I have like a 20 days continue viewing videos. The first time that I come across with this option. And one of the most important thing to me was looking all these guys trying to explain that the world isn't flat. So in 2017, 2016, see this, this kind of leaders talking about it. You don't hear him talking about reptilians or Anunnakis or cancer or whatever. And the only topic that these guys avoid is flat earth. So I don't know who write the speech to these guys, but they are really aware that this thing is coming out. So. I'm gonna start playing some clips, and just for you can feel it. So.
Joe Biden in the mayor. Yeah.
Creepy, vile, creepy Joe.
Creepy.
When you see this kind of thing, that you start thinking what's going on, because this kind of leader, they don't want first time, in conspiracy theories. It really don't be important. So the fact is that one in four Americans believe that the sun goes around the earth. 100 million people in America believe that. anything that's ahead, but you know, the science goes around here, that is a big issue for the election tomorrow. And when we Russians believe that, and that is important because those countries are the, supposedly the most, you know, better in space concerned stuff. And that is a red flag to keep in mind. But of course, right now, in only 5 years, we have like 20 million videos uploading to YouTube. So that's it for itself, you know, the statistics. The number doesn't lie, like NASA. So this is the real number. Ben Martin, there. So it's really amazing because I never see something in my 14 years of researcher. As a researcher, I never see something like that growing so quickly with some kind of these numbers. It's really, really something's going on. And recently, the problem, I believe the problem comes in this way, because now the flat earth is considered like a political issue, because we know what is going on if the earth is flat. So I'm going to play this little clip for from news.
Presentation should be about the history of humanity. They should have played Eric's video for an hour and a half so that the media would understand actually what the fuck's going on.
You know, when you see this, that kind of guys talking, okay, Donald Trump is not the serious guy, but, you know, yes, I'm just politician, but this guy is Nobel Prize.
And the Daily Telegraph.
And he's Ivan Gavier, so you can find it on Google. He really do great lectures, so I just, you know, take a 50 seconds part of that. But this is a physicist talking about the global warming cause, you know, and he talks about how he's pushed to say that the global warming is real, you know. So the other guy is a president, he's just a puppet, but this guy is a physicist, so for those who like physicists, hope, so I think, sorry for that. I can't scrap the video, so sorry for this interruption, but I want to, you can hear it. In this moment.
Okay, you might just want to tell us.
Don't ask of rats. Results from a new study reveal a third of young American millennials aren't sure that the Earth is round.
National poll found that 18 to 24-year-olds are the largest group in the country who believe the Earth could be flat. It seems the older you get, the more you believe the Earth is round.
Here's what 18 to 24-year-olds said when asked, do you believe the world is round or flat? 66% have always believed the Earth is round. 9% always thought the world was round, but more recently became skeptical. 5% always thought the world was flat, but more recently had doubts. Good for them. 4% always believed the world is flat.
That people should have a better understanding of why it is they believe what they believe.
I'm gonna keep it this morning if you don't mind, because some videos I need to scrub forward and backward, and I don't want to, you know, I just reduce this. So, usually for the, you know, for the journalist guy, there are two important things in that audio, in that video, which is, the first one is, when we believe in, what we believe, and the other thing is, at, you know, when you get older, you are more the heliocentric guy, but when you are younger, you are more flexible. Because that is when where everything starts. It's in the educational system. It's when you are young that they bring our, they wash our brain, because it's obviously more easy. So when you start to look in this situation about you know, be young guy and who puts information in your mind, is the UNESCO. That is because a lot of people start saying, okay, but this flat earth conspiracy, you need to get so many people involved, you know, the scientists, the pilot, the engineer, the astrophysicist, the physicist. So we can, you cannot do that. And it's not need to do that, because all the educational system, you can read it here. Educational, scientific, and cultural are made by only one organization, and that is all you need. All the plans in the universities, in the schools, in the media, all are based on this institution. And you know, of course, everybody knows the logo of the ONU. And we're going to start to make this little coincidence, because, for example, if you pronounce ONU backwards, is number one in Spanish, and our language comes from, you know, Greeks and Latin, and they don't lie, they just make things that we can understand because we don't have the same education that these guys have. So all the time to, like, you know, clean karma, they don't lie, they say the things in your face. The problem is that you don't understand what they say. So this is, you know, the principal institution that carry on the education of all the occidental part of the world. That's easy. This is, you know, triggers. So when you start to look at who founded these institutions, the first guy is Julian Huxley. And here we are going to start see, here you, we are going to start to see that these guys are all, you know, occultist backgrounds, you know. They all have, they all share that situation, and that is really, really important. Julian was, you know, the first, of course, they put nice words at the beginning. They say that there was an evolutionary biologist, greater humanist, all words to cover that the two that is, an oceanist, that is, you know, British international oceanist. He was the first director of UNESCO, and he supports the work of Charles Darwin. So with that sentence, you know, you have everything you need to know about Julian Huxley. But one of the brother called Aldous Huxley, he was in mysticism, and you start seeing like all these families share that kind of thing, you know, all the time. So the thing is, this guy, he wrote A Happy World, he wrote Alice in Wonderland, so you can start to see the connection here. He wrote The Iceland, which is, you know, like how to treat humans as animals, something like that, to take the organs. And of course, they wrote The Door of Perceptions. So, the guys who founded UNESCO, they are really occultist guys. They are not, I don't say good people, but they have knowledge that they don't share with us. So that is one of the problems to understand the flat earth. So this, you know, it's important because when you think in terms of spiritual level, anytime you reincarnate, you come with, you know, a biological software that allows to understand the world that surrounds you, because you need to survive, and that is why when you are young, you believe what yourself, or what the reality of the nature tell you. But as you grow up, you're gonna start to receive some upgrades for this life. So that is so easy to trigger. And this goes really, really deeply. I learned this from the channel of Brother Bassano. He is not anymore on YouTube, but he leave a nice research on his channel. And this comes from the University of Illinois, and it's from 2007. And this is a technical report across cultural investigation of children's conceptions about the Earth, the Sun, and the Moon, based on Greek and American data. So you can see here the important. They keep, you know, trying to get better brainwashing their own voice, because that is the key to make you believe in heliocentric model. So here you have, you know, just the abstract of that, and look here is what the result says. It's based on 90 children from Greek and 60 children from the United States. And the result of the study shows us that the children in both samples construct similar initial concept about the Earth. Both the Greeks and the American children conceptualize that the Earth as flat and stationary, and Flowey was located in the middle of the solar system. I know, I believe they know what I'm talking. They also thought that the things fall down now toward the center of the spherical Earth, and that the day and night cycle is caused by the movement of the Sun and the Moon. In the process of changing this concept, the Greeks and the American children formed similar misconceptions. So they assume that there are misconceptions right away, you know, which is a pretty, you know, strange, because that is what all of us see. You know, there is, I think, 80 astronauts supposedly see the world from outside, but the rest, we see all the time the same things. But this shows how important it is to, you know, infiltrate the educational system. In fact, in Argentina, for example, if you want to study for being a psychologist, in the introduction course, you're going to find these three topics, and I translated it for you. The first one is going to talk about the importance of the heliocentric model, because this theory locates the Sun as the center of the universe, displacing the paradigm of Ptolemy that placed the Earth in the privileged place. So we quit to a privileged place based on what? Because the observation showed that the Sun is moving, so we are the center. Developed by Copernicus in 14th century and retaken by Galileo in the 17th century, creating the modern astronomy. The second thing that you're gonna be aware if you want to be a psychologist, of course, is the evolution of the species. I don't need to tell you what it's about, because everybody knows we come from monkeys. And the third thing you're going to try to brainwash is with the discovery of the unconsciousness. So basically, Freud, after a period of time, when he comes to live in England with all kinds of privilege, they, you know, lead the instruction to how to make the feminist revolution in the beginning of the 1950s. After all that, he also tell us that even our thoughts are not ours, you know, because the subconscious is going to trick you all the time. If you are not even in your spirit, I mean, that is the kind of, you know, talking a few words where you're going to study if you want to be a psychologist. But maybe someday we need to go to, you know, a psychologist, because we are psychologists, and maybe the time is going to be a cease. So how are you going to fight with a psychologist?
That's a different challenge.
But this is how deep it's called. You know, I mean, all these professionals, yeah, receive the same educational system, so that is why they are not part of the conspiracy. They are part of the brainwashing that every one of us suffer. And if you Trump is one of these career you cannot study in any place in the world. And that is astronaut. You cannot be studied to be an astronaut. You must be selected by finger, you know? Like be a 33-degree Mason, you must be selected. And that is a little strange because why is, you know, it's like being Pope. You can't study to be Pope. In fact, if you are a woman, you're never going to be a Pope. So you can start see how the heliocentric model is a masculine, you know, model that's trying all the time to get out the feminine part, because the feminine part is the creativity, is, you know, is the emotional part. And they're trying to get rid of that. That is why we live in the paradigm of the right is to have the reason. You know, if you are, you know, left side, you don't work nothing. And this is how to be, you know, how the universities come from. I mean, this is my concept, you know, it's not just scientific proof that this is where the first university come from, but here we're going to start entering in the scientific realm. University, of course, means one verse, one story, you know, one model. That is, universe is just one, and who creates the one, that is the important thing. So you must be remembered that nobody has access to free, you know, quote, educational system until 50 years back. You know, for the beginning of the 20th century, the most of the world was uneducated. So that is how far the things goes. And the first one, if you want to really have access to some kind of education, you must be a religious person. That was the first one that knows how write, how read, have access to really instruments to, you know, put words on paper. I mean, the paper was supposedly invented in China 100 years before Christ. So you must be in the noble families to get access to the, if you're a poor guy or a normal guy, you don't even know how to write. So that is a red flag for every religious book that we consume today. Because I am not against any religions. Everyone can do whatever you want, but think about it, the Gospels, who supposedly was written by the, you know, the guys who walked with Jesus, they don't have access to write nothing. They don't come home and say, okay, I'm gonna write what the master teaching me now, give me a pen. They don't have that kind of instrument. So that kind of text was written by the same guy that today print our educational and religious book. I don't say that religions are fake, because I believe that they are real, but we need to, you know, try to separate and really study really deeply, because that is, you know, the real thing. They don't have things to write. Only the, you know, religious people have the instruments to write down at that time. So this is where the first university start. I mean, university, but, you know, under the concept of to have instruments to write down ideas, concepts, and that kind of things. And once they, you know, this comes from Babylon and until our days. But in the sometimes in the, you know, in the history around the 16th century, the religious order has everything tied up. They start to expand. And the first guy who received education was alchemist, you know, occultist. That was the first guy that had access to non-bias, I mean, to, you know, just a few things, you know, the religious people, the really high priests say, okay, we need to brainwash the world. So we need people to teach what we want to you know, to this guy learn. So they start, you know, selecting people and say, okay, I'm gonna teach you some things just for you can do my purpose. So the first guy was, you know, the alchemist, the occultist guys, who start really have information, and that is all about the Kabbalah, all about the, you know, the mysticism, arts, the hermetics, arts, that kind of things. Of course, after that, you know, like in the 17th, 18th, 19th century, if you want to have access to education, you literally need give your life to Vatican. I mean, you cannot go to university, because at that time that doesn't exist. You need to go to a monastery or to a convent. I mean, you need to go to these religious institutions, and you need to sacrifice your life just for, you know, get knowledge. And the knowledge you're gonna get is like the same UNESCO, but at that time. And it's really strange, you know, not strange, but this is the things that, for example, the word library in Spanish, it's called biblioteca. And the word biblioteca, it's come from Bible. I mean, we know that the Bible is, you know, a collection of writings. It's not just one book who someone writes. So that give you, you know, a little hint where the books really are. They are in the library, in the biblioteca, because the religious people is who they have that kind of information. And after all that, a few families in Italy start founding the Jesuit and the Pope order. That is where the Catholic, you know, church begins. Speaking, it was the Medici, the Ornesi, the Farnesi. Those guys we still living and still use the same surname, and they still have their own companies. You know, they founded the Jesuit order and the Pope. They are who they founded. They are not, you know, the Pope is not a religious guy that was selected, nothing like that. Was founded what at the same that the science is founded today. And here start to appear the first scientists. For example, I'm going to show, you know, a little bit of examples of why we believe that the world is so spherical. For example, this guy, one of the first Jesuits called Anastasis Kirchberg, he was considered by his fellow as the Leonardo da Vinci of his time. He was honored with the Master of Hundred Arts. And this guy, for example, what was the first one, of course, he was the mystery of the human knowledge. He was an occultist, he was a magician, he was an astronomy. But all the time, what you're gonna see is the relationship with mysticism. It doesn't matter if you are a scientist, if you are a religious person, if you are a Jesuit, if you are, you know, Egyptian. All the time, the guys who give us the actual science, they are not scientists. They are magicians. So we must be, you know, keep in mind of that. He studied the hermetics, magic, and alchemy. So it's even, you know, he studied the symbology, the secrecy, the magic, the Kabbalah. So even the Kabbalah is, you know, maybe they share knowledge with the Hebrew people, but the Jesuit is also involved in that kind of knowledge. And this guy was the first guy who proposed that the earth has a core inside. So it's not come from any scientist, any modern scientist. This Jesuit created the idea, you know, you can see the angels, you know, blowing the winds. And that is the core of the earth. So he, you know, maybe one day wake up and say, you know, inside of a spherical planet there is a core. And here you can see another depictions from the Coriolis effects. This is like the first, you know, Coriolis effects concept. And the sun, the moon, Polaris. Maybe you can see here that this is the shadow produced maybe by Polaris, maybe the eclipse. Are not, you know, the lunar eclipse are not produced, of course, by the shadow of the Earth. Maybe there is some other object that produces that shadow. And, okay, that was the nucleus core idea. And it's really nice because the word nucleus, core for English people, in Spanish is núcleo. I don't know if here is the same word. But they all the time, they refer, for example, Leonardo da Vinci. Da Vinci means give life. And Leonardo is lion, is the lion. And we know who families use the lion in his shields, you know, family shields. And when you start to analyze the word, for example, the word nucleus, nu means light. That is where the root of the word north comes from. My channel is called Nur for everyone, because Nur or north means light of the center. North means light of the center. That is what this means, not, you know, some geographical point is referred to the light in the center. And the word nucleus means light for Cleo. You remember Cleopatra? Is the patria of the lion. That is the symbolic of the lion in Egypt. So it's like they put like his symbol inside the earth all the time. In fact, to access this in the mathematical world, you want to call radio. And radio, if you separate the word, you have Ra Dio, Ra God, inside of the earth. So, you know, you can believe what you want, you can maybe believe that it's all coincidence, you know, coincidence, but when you start look really deeply, you can see how this matrix is start forming. So, don't forget that supposedly the most important library in the world is from Vatican, so you cannot have access to that kind of education. You know, so that is how deep the things goes. And of course, after, you know, first the higher priests make the history and universities, then they pass to alchemists, which is some kind of scientist, and then they founded and create the Freemasonry to take care of the universities, because in any university you're gonna find Freemasonry in every book text, in every scientific facts. Always is going to be a free nation will teach you what you need to believe or what you need to research. And the first guy who founded the Freemason, one of the father of the Freemasonry, is a guy born here in British. His name is Elias, at least the artistic name, because Ashmolé means dragon. Elias Ashmolé is considered one of the father of the Freemasonry. He contributed to this extensive knowledge related to Egyptian and Hermetic symbols. And that is why all the time in Freemasonry you're going to see Egyptian symbols. Because they took the knowledge, you know, what, from Babylon, then from Egypt, then from Greeks, and all the time you're going to see this situation. That is why I talk about the lion inside of the supposed spherical earth. So they put, you know, their symbols, but we don't have the knowledge to understand that. He dealt with astrologers, alchemists, mathematicians. He founded the Royal Society of London and the Philosophical Society of Oxford. So he wants to make, you know, everything he wants, because he lived with all these kind of professions. He founded the Royal Society of London. So this is like a, you know, the first approach of the UNESCO at that time. But this guy, the guy was a heliocentric guy in that time. So that idea that, no, the Greeks know that the sun was fixed and the earth revolved around the sun, that is all right. You can see some concept art from that idea. This, you can see the first idea of the spherical earth projecting shadow. I don't know where, because this is supposed to be space. There is no any particles to project nothing. You can see here the moon. You can here see all the books that this guy wrote. Of course, all based on mysticism and natural forces and that. But one of the guys who come later, working with Elias Ashmolé, was this guy, Robert Plot, you know, nice surname, for what he's doing. And I mean, he's another coincidence, surname of this guy, because this guy was the first to propose the crop cycle. This guy was the first to propose the dinosaur. I mean, remember what clock means. This keeper of the Ashmolean Museum, I mean the museum of the other guy, in 1686, British naturalist Robert Plot reported on rings of arc of mushroom as like a, oh, look that, maybe a demon, an alien, too. No, that is something to be aware, because we believe that the crop cycle is something that born in 20th century, like this is modern thing, but not. It's from the few centuries ago, and all is related with Freemasonry. Remember, I used to study the crop cycle because I was a big fan of NASA and alien stuff and that kind of thing. And the most important message in the crop cycle world is this message here that supposedly comes from this information on the Voyager disk. So, if you have that, it's very easy to understand that we made the crop cycles. There is no enforcement in it. Maybe there are mental guys or some kind of technology that we don't know. But where is the Voyager? I mean, who read the message of the Voyager? There is no stage, there is no Voyager, there is nothing like that. So this message did not come from any species out there reading this on the Voyager station. So life. Easy as that. And then supposedly, this is the other one that wants to believe that an alien comes and make his portrait here and that kind of thing. I can do nothing for you. That's really a thing. And you know, this is like a ISS concept. I'm going to show you later how the ISS get better from the 70s to our days. And supposedly the aliens get better drawing cycles, because they start like this, you know, and then as the technology grows, even the aliens grows, you know, how to draw, and they come with that kind of things. It's a really shame for advanced civilization, but you can see a lot of documentary showing how easy it is in one night three guys doing really complex crop cycles without breaking the planets and everything like that. And remember, you guys have the most amount of crop cycles here in England, and the guy who proposed that is from England. So, of course, he's going to have it. So, you know, the dinosaur thing, for me, that is my concept, because it's come from this guy, too. I mean, it's not coming from any revolutionary guy in the 20th century. It's like, you know, you take the concept of the turtle, you mix it up with the dragon of Komodo, with the rhino, and with the giraffe, and you painting green, put some spike, and here is the dinosaur. Because it's like a reverse engineering, you know? You take the giraffe, and they make the brontosaurus. They take the rhino, and they make the triceratops. I mean, it's just that, you know? They inspire nature, because this guy was a naturalist, and he painted green, and put some spike, and there you have the dinosaur there. So, as you keep going, all the time you're going to see the Jesuit intervention in every place of education. In fact, one of the first universities has the name of, this is the United States, has the name of the founder of the Jesuit, which was the Loyola, Ignacio de Loyola. And this is the guy, you know, here. And they are the symbols of the educational system from Vatican. And maybe you believe, like, for example, in Argentina, you have supposedly freely education without any religious behind that. But that is like, in fact, we don't see the word. But I mean, there is no real education without all these guys behind, you know, the scenes. And of course, they support the global earth. They created that concept. And in every symbol you're going to see out there, it's going to be writing in letters that you don't have the knowledge to understand what it says. Like that he said he had the time to read, you know, the priest talking in Latin, you know, in this ceremonies. For example, this is the shield of Yale University, Lux et Veritas, light is the truth. And we know when this guy talks about light, you know, we know how why they talk about light. And in fact, when you get, you know, when you finish an educational system in a lot of countries, you dress like this because they convert you in a Jesuit. Symbolically, you just that. That is why you dress in this way. And the people, they believe, I don't know what they believe, because in Argentina it's not that kind of ceremony, but I don't think so that those guys know where I where what they are wearing.
The power's going to go in a minute.
For example, another terminology in Latin to us don't understand what they're talking about. One of the part of the ONU, you know, responsible for our security, called SHEI, means the Supreme Headquarters Allied Power Europe. They have, of course, the pyramid symbol and all that kind of stuff, but in Latin they say the price of freedom is civilians. That is it. Really high cost, you know. In our times with all drones, technology out there, all cameras, that is why they maybe they do it. And just a little example for you understand what I'm talking, when I'm trying to say what the importance of the meaning of the word are. Supposedly, the old record that we have about language. This comes from the Sumerian and pre-Sumerian people. After that, you must believe that we live in caves, you know, ripping off a woman of the hair and that kind of things. And after that, Babylon City appears. Nobody knows how. But we know that we are not like a, you know, a spontaneous creation. So these guys were the first language, then come these other languages until our days that we only use the Anglo-Saxon and the Spanish language. And one of the races that ruled the world, they never changed their language, which are the Hebrew. They keep speaking the original language. And that, you know, that has a meaning. But we are, look how many photocopies, if you want to see in that way, we have until our language. And for example, all the time, we know we live in the slave system. And all the time, for example, the system tell you, hey, you must be, the first thing is a family. But family means, come from family, and means servant or slave. So when you talk about my family, you're talking about your slave group. They don't talk about family, they talk about bloodlines. Because what you share is lineage, it's blood. You don't share slavery. That is the real thing. So I don't talk anymore about saying, okay, my family, I go into bring my family on vacation. I talk, you know, because when you say more immediate, so you need to start changing some words if you want to be more free, if you want to see that word. But like I tell you before, be a famous. Be part of our family, be our slave. Because that is what they are telling you, you know, in symbolic language. Be a famous is just be a slave with the original word. That is why they propose all the time, hey, you want to be famous? Yeah, I want to be. And if you become a famous, you lose your life. And you're just working for them. We know that this guy, they don't even have money. I mean, all the money of these guys have is in a digital account, so if you don't do what they want you do, they just persecute and erase your account, that easy. So, to understand all these kind of things, you must be understand one of the most important concept out there based on education, different education, which of course come from Greeks, you know, so you must be see in, you know, with suspicious way, because the guys who printed today, of course, I believe that they suppress some information, but that is the Tribune and the Quadrivium. These are considered the liberal arts of education. So all the time they use a liberal, you know, system, and for us they give us a slavery system. In fact, that here says literally, these disciplines was cultivated by free men as opposed to the serving arts, typically of the servants or slave. So the our education system is based on be slave, not be free man. And that is why they are so afraid to art, because if you become an artist, whatever discipline you wanna do, you're gonna get free. You're gonna be independent, because you don't need to wake up all the days to go to work for other people. That is why they don't want to the feminine part, you know, in our lives. And this is a quote from one of the biggest motherfuckers out there, which is J.P. Morgan. No, we know that this guy preferred, you know, the Titanic for to the own things and bring down Tesla. And he said, millionaires don't lose anthropology, billionaires do. And that is important, the importance of understanding how the planets work, because the planets are light and energy, so you can use that energy for good, for bad, but you need to understand why they are there. And of course, in the, you know, in the heliocentric model, that doesn't have any sense, because millions of years away, what is going to affect us? Nothing. You know, the moon rock affect the feminine menstrual cycle. What is it? It's a rock. I mean, that doesn't have any sense. But if you start looking in the way that everything out there is